I push open a heavy wooden door and walk down a narrow corridor to an Ethiopian chapel.
አብየቱ ካንተ ዘንድ የምንሻውን በምንለምንበት በምንጸልይበት ጊዜ እናስባቸው ዘንድ አስቡን ያሉን አስብ አብየቱ ፈጣሪያችን እግዚአብሔር ከኛ አስቀድመው የሞቱትን አሳርፋቸው የታመሙትንም ፈጥነ አድናቸው.
The winding path ends suddenly next to the Holy Sepulchre's main entrance.
Heureux sont-ils tous ceux qui là ont pleuré d'amour céleste. Le prêtre grec a pris une rose, l'a jetée sur la dalle, y a versé de l'eau de rose, l'a bénite et me l'a donnée. Ça a été un des moments les plus amers de ma vie, c'eût été si doux pour un fidèle. Combien de pauvres âmes auraient souhaité être à ma place, comme tout cela était perdu pour moi. Pendant que nous visitions le Saint-Sépulcre, j'ai entendu 4 heures sonner aux différentes horloges des églises.
At the end of his visit to the church, Flaubert wrote without further comment.
Le meurtre d'un juif sur la place du Saint-Sépulcre se rachète par 60 paras.
On the lowest rung of the social ladder are the Jews. One of the earliest photographs of the war, the year 1864. As a child, I was only able to see the war in photographs. It was hidden behind the border, deep within the old city. Why are the Jews so sad? Their clothes are worn, and their faces turn to a wall in ruins. Today is the 9th of Av. 1,920 years have passed since the great destruction, and it is still mourned. But the state of Israel was resurrected, and its soldiers are posted on the wall above. The people at prayer. The religious establishment took over the place and erected the barrier between men and women. What I love are the old pictures of the Western Wall, a ravaged wall filled with memories, absorbing tears, comforting those who suffer. Wicker baskets hang on the wall. A donkey is tied to a fence across the way. A narrow space, 3 meters wide, at the bottom of the imposing Herodian structure. The year 1870. Above lies the vast Temple Mount, where only Muslims could enter. Erected by Caliph Abd al-Malik, the Dome of the Rock has been standing here for 1300 years. Only from the end of the 19th century were Western visitors allowed to enter the mosques and the surrounding area. the end of the 19th century. First color photograph of the war. The camera captured an everyday scene. Women and men are praying side by side. This is the last photo I found of people praying at the wall before the War of 48. For 19 years, the wall stood orphaned. The entire old city was in Jordanian territory. In 67, amidst the enthusiasm of the Six-Day War victory, the army foresees tens of thousands of visitors to the wall. So in one night, they demolished the entire Maghrebi quarter that hindered access to the site. In its place, a vast, ugly space was paved, blinding under the burning sun. It is hard for me to film here. After things calmed down a bit, the Dutch landscape painter Cornelius de Bruijn arrived in Jerusalem. He stood in the old cemetery, hiding his pencils for fear of being accused of spying, and secretly sketched the most precise panorama of Jerusalem made before the invention of photography.
Des andere daags morgens, de 19e oktober, vervoegde ik mij bovenop het klooster en tekende vandaar het gezicht der kerk van het heilige graf.
The building stood intact since it was abandoned by the crusaders 500 years earlier. Only the top floor of the tower was crumbling down. Today, another 300 years have passed, and the top floors of the tower have disappeared.
Indien nu iemand wil weten hoe men zich gesteld bevindt als men de eerste maal voor des heilands graf nederknielt, ik zal hem zeggen, voor zoveel mij belangt, dat ik nergens enige ontroering heb gevoeld als alleen daar. Doch ontstelde zich een der paters, mede een nieuweling in Jeruzalem, die met mij in de kerk ging vrij wat meer. Want knielende neder voor het heilige graf, berstte hij uit in zulk een overvloed van tranen en zuchten, dat hij in 2 uren nauwelijks tot bedaren was te brengen.
Jerusalem, 1806, from the travelogue of Chateaubriand.
Le guide s'écria, El Kotz, la Sainte, et il s'enfuit au grand galop. Je restai les yeux fixés sur Jérusalem, mesurant la hauteur de ses murs, recevant à la fois tous les souvenirs de l'histoire, depuis Abraham jusqu'à Godefroy de Bouillon, pensant au monde entier changé par la mission du Fils de l'homme, et cherchant vainement ce temple dont il ne reste pas pierre sur pierre. Comme nous approchions de la porte de la ville, porte de Jaffa, le pacha sortait de Jérusalem. Je fus obligé d'ôter promptement le mouchoir que j'avais jeté sur mon chapeau pour me défendre du soleil, dans la crainte de m'attirer une disgrâce. Nous prîmes une rue qui se dirige de l'ouest à l'est et qu'on appelle la rue du Bazar. C'est la grande rue et le beau quartier de Jérusalem. Mais quelle désolation et quelle misère! Nous ne rencontrions personne, car la plupart des habitants s'étaient retirés dans la montagne à l'arrivée du pacha. À la droite du bazar, nous entrâmes dans le quartier des Juifs. Ceux-ci, fortifiés par leur misère, avaient bravé l'assaut du pacha. Ils étaient là, tous en guenilles, assis dans la poussière de Sion, cherchant les insectes qui les dévoraient, et les yeux attachés sur le temple. Le dragoman me fit entrer dans une espèce d'école. Je voulus acheter le Pentateuque hébreu dans lequel un rabbin montrait à lire à un enfant. Mais le rabbin ne voulut jamais me le vendre.
Chateaubriand stayed in the city for several days.
Le 12 octobre, nous sortîmes de la ville au coucher du soleil par la porte des pèlerins. Nous traversâmes le camp du pacha. Je m'arrêtai avant de descendre dans la vallée de Térébinthe pour regarder encore Jérusalem. Il était 6h29 lorsque je perdus de vue la cité sainte. Le navigateur marque ainsi le moment où disparaît à ses yeux une terre lointaine qu'il ne reverra jamais.
The city was at its lowest ebb. Only 4,000 Muslims, 2,500 Christians, and 2,000 Jews lived within her walls. The French poet Lamartine walks around the city walls, stands before the open, desolate gate, but is unable to enter. A plague is ravaging the city.
Le même vide, le même silence que si nous eussions passé devant les portes mortes de Pompéi ou l'Herculanum. Nous ne vîmes que quatre convois funèbres sortir en silence de la porte de Damas et s'acheminer le long des murs vers les cimetières turcs.
Lamartine was forced to stay at St. John's Monastery in the mountainous village of En Karim, west of Jerusalem, believed to be the birthplace of St. John the Baptist.
Du toit du couvent, on plonge toutes parts sur des abîmes sans fond. Quelques pauvres maisons d'arabes mahométans et chrétiens sont groupées sur le rocher à l'ombre du monastère.
The windows of my house look eastward on St. John's Monastery. Here, in an old house which I renovated, I have lived for more than 20 years. I have distanced myself from Judaism. At the end of 1839, the first photographer, Goupil Fesquet, appears in Jerusalem, accompanied by his uncle, the renowned painter Horace Vernet. All the photos were lost. All that remains is the photographer's illustrated journal.
La pluie qui tombe assez d'amande nous accompagne partout. Néanmoins, elle ne m'empêche point de faire quelques daguerréotypes. Une épreuve des remparts prise du côté du château de David me paraît digne de la reproduction photogénique. Je m'enveloppe donc d'un grand abat noir qui me sert de guérite et me dirigeant vers la montagne voisine, je braque ma chambre obscure sur le point de vue que je désire, après avoir longtemps examiné le site et cherché des petites pierres convenables pour consolider l'appareil. Pendant que je me livre à l'orientation de mon daguerréotype, il fait un vent très désagréable qui dérange l'équilibre de mon installation et troublera infailliblement les contours de mon épreuve. Pour surcroît de misère, deux juifs qui se promènent près de moi vont et viennent devant l'objectif sans qu'il me soit possible de leur en faire comprendre l'inconvénient. Ils s'approchent de moi, je leur fais signe de s'éloigner, ils n'en font rien. L'un d'eux se met à rire et se place exprès pour me contrarier devant la lentille. Irrité de ce procédé, je le prends par les épaules et le pousse à quatre pas de là. Son camarade le remplace au poste perdu. Je reviens à la charge et j'y ajoute quelques bons coups de poing solidement appliqués. J'en distribue libéralement à l'un et à l'autre et je suis étonné de l'imperturbable lâcheté avec laquelle chacun d'eux reçoit alternativement sa dose, sans essayer même de se défendre le moins du monde. Finalement, ils comprennent qu'ils m'ont importuné et s'en vont, sans montrer aucune apparence de ressentiment, regagnant le plus affreux quartier de la ville.
The French photographer didn't know that during those very days, the Jews of Jerusalem were expecting the imminent coming of the Messiah, as the year 5600 had already begun. The Messiah didn't arrive. After hundreds of years, construction in Jerusalem had begun again. 6,000 Muslims, 4,000 Christians, and 8,000 Jews live within the city walls by 1860. Near Jaffa Gate, inside the old city, a new hotel is being built, the Grand New Hotel. The pile of stones on the ground is for the second floor. Jaffa Road, a stream of passers-by all day long. Around the Mamila pool at the Muslim cemetery, women and men gaze at the water. In the background, the first houses of the Mamila neighborhood. The first cinematographer arrives in Jerusalem, sent by the Lumière brothers. Instead of filming the famous sites, he sets up his camera near Jaffa Gate, the busiest place in the city, and films its inhabitants. On the other side of the gate, he recalls a row of Turkish soldiers returning to the citadel. The municipality of Jerusalem resides in the triangular building seen in the background. It was built on the corner of Jaffa and Mamila roads, the center of the new city. Morning, December 25, 1994. For 8 years, I have been working on this film. In the meantime, Noah is already a soldier. Yael is 17, before her last high school exams. And Naomi is 15. This is how the Jaffa Gate looked 100 years ago. Bonfils, the photographer, searches out a vantage point on the Jaffa Road, the first street outside the walls. He stood behind a window overlooking the Jaffa Mamila junction. The building no longer exists. In the introduction to his book, Bonfils wrote,
"No country has been destroyed over and over again in wars more than this one. And no country has seen more rulers come and go. And despite all that, this country, holy to all, has perhaps more than any other country preserved its ancient character. But we have to hurry if we wish to enjoy what our eyes behold.
progress, that great deceiver, will surely hasten its destructive handiwork of what time itself has treated with respect. In the ancient plain of Charon, the shriek of a locomotive engine is already to be heard. Perhaps the day is not far off when the Holy Mount of Olives will have its own cable car like every other tourist site. Before this comes about, we have tried to immortalize the country, as it were, freezing it in a series of photographic shots.
Traffic jam at the Jaffa Gate. The Turks decide to undertake large-scale development works. They fill in the deep moat from the Crusader period, enabling access of wagons in the breach between the citadel and the ancient gate. Here you feel the pulse of the New Jerusalem. In the last days of the Ottoman Empire, the Turks built on the Jaffa Gate a clock tower of new white stone. Among the many photographs I collected, I found a postcard of Ain Karim, a small village 2 hours' walk from the Jaffa Gate. For over 20 years, I've lived in Ain Karim. My house is on the hill, opposite the Church of John the Baptist. Beyond the house, fields. Among the fields, at the top of the hill, there's a long building surrounded by walls. This is where Jerusalem ends today. On the patio, Yael interviews my parents. She has to prepare a report about her family history for school.
Eli ben Yosef Chavilio, Mishnat 1472, Besfarad. Mu'uchar yoter, aya Rabbi David Chavilio, ish Kabbalah gadol. Ata yodat ma ze Kabbalah?
Whereas my father was always very proud of his family origins, I knew very little about my mother's side, the Rosenthal family.
צריך להדגיש שזה היה בתקופה שאנשים היו לוחמות של ממש.
עכשיו...
אצלי היו...
לא בשירות העזר. כך שחיה, שקט, אני פה כתוב, כך שחיה הייתה בעצמה מפקדת חזית. שתדעו.
אני עליתי להר ציון, בלילה שכבשו את זה, הפלמ"ח כבש את זה, ואחר כך היו באמת חיילות בהר ציון, והם היו בעמדות, בתפקידים קשים. כלומר, הדברים לא... היה קשה להסביר להם, כי בעיר היו להם משפחות, וכל הזמן היו הפגזות.
Jaffa Gate, in wartime. Jamal Pasha, high commander of the Turkish army, leaves the city on his way to the front. The winds of violence sweeping across the world have reached this place. Thank you. People are being hanged at the Jaffa Gate as deserters, spies, or mere suspects. A sign on the victim gives some explanation. Its real intention: to intimidate the population.
Father, who had to carry baked foods to the market, could have been caught at any time by the Turkish secret police, who roamed the streets to catch any man who looked fit for the army. When the gallop of the secret police was heard, all the men would run away. When they caught someone who didn't have the strength to flee, he would be gasping like a fish in their claws, listless, stiff with fear, the face contorted. They took the conscripts away, nobody knew where. I had to take on some of the burden of earning a living. The first thing I did was to take cakes my mother had baked. I gathered courage and came to the Jaffa Gate. I sat on some steps with my tray, and from time to time I shouted, "Hot cakes, hot cakes." At first the sales went well, but very quickly people stopped paying attention and left me alone. By sunset, my success was so minimal that I walked around crying soundlessly. Eventually, my efforts were in vain, and when the flour in the city ran out, I stopped, without knowing what would happen to my starving family.
Austrian soldiers pass in front of the Jaffa Gate. Jamal Pasha welcomes General Erich von Falkenhayn at the Jerusalem railway station. The Prussian General von Kressenstein. The General sits in his car at the entrance to Hotel Fast. Hunger and plagues spread across the country.
At evening, when darkness brought bitter sadness upon me, I would follow Hamid, the Arab shepherd, who brought his shriveled sheep and goats to the marketplace. When he finished milking them, he would set pieces of kuzba, the leftovers from pressing olive oil. It's brown and has a bittersweet taste, and he gave us kids a little. Sometimes we would take what fell from the goat's mouth, pieces wet from the saliva and full of the smell of their manure. This was our dinner. My grandfather, Nisim Khavilio, was 30 years older than Sarina. He had 7 children from his first wife, who died during the war.
Mm-hmm. יהודי אלמן, וגם בעל יכולת, הוא היה הרי את התעשייה הזאת, הוא בא והייתה מלחמה, לא הייתה פרנסה, לא היה מה לאכול, אז התפטרו, מדוע לא? זה היה מעשה טבעי מאוד. דרך אגב, הייתה אישה יפה מאוד, מאוד יפה.
כן?
מאוד יפה. אני זוכר אותה.
כן, אתה זוכר שהייתה...
שזה לא שרוצה לפקוט. שם עוד יפה.
After the wedding, Sarina posed with her mother and younger sisters. She would soon give birth to my father and call him Shlomo after her own father. December 9, 1917. The victorious British army is approaching Jerusalem. A delegation of notables carrying a white flag goes out to surrender. In one of Larsen's photos, the mayor El Husseini presents the keys of the city to two British sergeants who have lost their way. It reminds me of the heroic surrender of the city of Breda in the Velázquez picture. I reflect on the power of a photo to reveal the real face of war, the face of absurdity.
וביום שבת, לפני שהצבא הבריטי נכנס, הטורקים עזבו את המשרדים, והצעירים הירושלמים הלכו לבניינים האלה לתפוס שלל.
אפרים פריצקי is my mother's uncle. I sat with him in the car by the Jaffa gate. When the British conquered Jerusalem, Ephraim was 7 years old.
וגם אני הבאתי הביתה ארגז תרופות, ואבא גירש אותי עם ארגז התרופות האלה. ולמוחרת ביום שישי התחילו לצאת לראות איך החיילים האנגלים מגיעים, ואני הייתי בין אלה שיצאתי לשער יפו וראיתי שגלים גלים עולים החיל הרגלים הבריטי, עייפים ורצוצים, והם שכבו על הרצפה לנוח, על השכבה. ואנחנו חשבנו לתומנו, החיילים האלה יכלו לגרש את הטורקים.
The British hastened to correct the bad impression made by the soldiers, turning from matters of war to stage with great pomp a triumphal entry into the holy city. They marched along the Jaffa Road. Half the Jews that had been in Jerusalem on the eve of the war are no longer in the city. 9,000 had died of illness and hunger. The rest were driven out, conscripted, or had fled the border. Winter 1918. The war drags on in the north of the country. A convoy of camels of the British Supply Corps makes its way slowly along the Jaffa Road next to the gate, passing below the clock tower. The English did not think much of the clock tower above the Jaffa Gate. They found it eclectic in style, spoiling the biblical impression of the walls. It was dismantled a few months after the great snowfall of 1920. January 1992. Snow fell the whole night. For many years, Jerusalem had not been seen in such a white covering. During the winter of 1920, snow had fallen unceasingly for a week, the heaviest snow ever recorded in the city. Many old houses were damaged. People froze from the cold. Outside the old city, the Jaffa Road was blocked off. A narrow path makes its way to the Jaffa Gate. On the left is the clock tower. To the right, the citadel. Next to the Jaffa Gate, I was caught in a snowstorm. Here, the wall is bare, providing no shelter. All the buildings that stood here on both sides of Jaffa Road were destroyed long ago. Inside the old city, within the citadel, I went into the Petra Hotel. In the Ottoman period, wealthy travelers from distant lands would stay here. Melting snow drips in from the roof and floods the splendid marble floors. The windows look out over the Church of the Holy Sepulchre and Hezekiah's ancient pool. Today, the hotel is neglected and serves as a hostel for young tourists. All the wooden steps lead up to the roof. In 1920, Yaakov Ben Dov took from here a photo of the Jewish quarter with the domes of the synagogues. The ancient palm tree can still be seen in the picture. The large dome to the right is that of the Churva synagogue. It collapsed in 1948 when the Arab Legion blew up the building. The Havilio family lived for decades in this house next to the Churva synagogue. Here my father was born 1 year after the great snow in April 1921. It's here, on the Temple Mount, that during the 1920s, the stirring up of the crowds of faithful Muslims led to the first acts of violence against the Jews.
אז אני זוכר בקצה הגבול בין אירופה לשוק היו יושבים על דרגשים שוטרים בריטים ושוטרים ערבים ושוטרים יהודים ושומרים על הפתח של הרובה שלא ייכנסו ערבים לרובה ואני כילד הייתי עומד לפעמים שעות להסתכל על השוטרים ולהסתכל על הרובים שלהם ולנחש איך הם יורים. אני מדבר על גיל של 6-7. אז זה היה כבר אז מעניין אותי איך הרובה יורה.
A cross reflected in a puddle of water. Jews didn't live in the Christian quarter, perhaps because of a deep-rooted fear of the cross. Many preferred to live in the Muslim quarter. Today, however, danger to Jews in Israel could come from the Muslim world. I'm afraid to venture into the dark alleys, and I keep to the main axis of Elwad Street. I've walked down the Via Dolorosa and come to the Muslim quarter. Next to the sixth station of the cross, an Arab child tries to draw my attention to a small souvenir store named after Saint Veronica.
Santa Veronica left the shop. Santa Veronica is the face of Jesus.
When Jesus passed by here, staggering under the cross, Veronica wiped his brow. Jesus' features were left traced on Veronica's white handkerchief. Many photographers before me stood here by the fifth station to catch a picturesque view of the Via Dolorosa. For hundreds of years, this barred window has looked out on the intersection of Via Dolorosa and Elwad Street. Elwad winds its way along the lower side of the old city. It's the main artery of the Muslim quarter. Above the street, a house which was once splendid, a vestige of the great days of Islamic culture. Now rule Palestine. The month my father was born, a photo was taken of the new rulers in Cairo. Churchill, Secretary of State for the colonies, sits next to Herbert Samuel, the first High Commissioner of Palestine. For the picture, a red oriental carpet has been spread outside. Stretched out on it, two predators from the colonial jungles. Next to them is the tamer, probably Sudanese. Jerusalem. Indian soldiers of His Majesty the King before the ancient citadel. At the Jaffa Gate, they are checking passers-by. This is where the violent conflict between Jews and Arabs first broke out. Jaffa Gate, early 1920s, a quiet winter's day. The clock tower is gone. The Ottoman crescent is still painted on the gate. The 1930s along the Jaffa Road. A zeppelin flies over the sky of Jerusalem like a bad omen. All the buildings in photo, up to the Citadel Tower, which can be seen on the horizon, will disappear in the rapidly approaching storm. The Nazi flag was raised by the German owners of the Fast Hotel. 1936, riots at the Jaffa Gate. A wave of national extremism sweeps up the Arab masses. They rebel against British authority, they attack Jews. Going to civil war, bands of armed gangs under the sway of the Mufti of Jerusalem murder around 2,000 Arab intellectuals and moderates. In Europe, at the same time, the Second World War is raging. But when I look at Father's photo album, I see happy young people always together, climbing over rocks, breathing in the Mediterranean air. Here in this country, for this once, the war passed it by. On the thick binding of the family album, Herzl's portrait is engraved, and in the first page, a copy of Haaretz from November 30.
Afghanistan? No. Argentina?
The United Nations decides by a majority to establish a Jewish state.
Belgium? Yes. Bolivia? Yes.
An Arab-Palestinian state Brazil? Alongside it?
Yes.
And Jerusalem declared an international city.
Yes. Canada? Yes. Chile?
On one of the inside pages of that same newspaper, there's a notice about the marriage ceremony of father and mother on December 2nd in Pension Vita in Jerusalem at 3:30 in the afternoon. December 2nd, 1947, 9:30 a.m. A seething Arab mob moves through the Jaffa Gate and bursts into Mamila Street. From there, it fans out into the new commercial center. The British police evacuate Jews from the center, preventing Haganah units from entering the area, but does not stop the Arab rioters. They burst into Jewish stores, breaking, looting, vandalizing all within reach, setting them on fire. The echoes of the explosions and the sight of the thick smoke reaches all the way to Zion Square. A raging Jewish crowd tries to reach the commercial center. Shortly after, Jewish youth and members of the Irgun set fire to the Rex cinema.
הייתי טרוד בכל הנושאים האלו של כוננות, גיוס, הצטיידות של היישובים. ופתאום אני שם לב ואני רואה שכבר כבר שעות הצהריים המאוחרות. ונזכרתי שיש לך חתונה, שאני צריך להתחתן. ואז כמובן עזבתי הכל, ורצתי הביתה. רצתי הביתה למחנה יהודה להתלבש. הם כבר היו כולם על קוצים, הם כבר מוכנים היו, היא הייתה לבושה, כולם היו לבושים כדי לגשת לחתונה.
Delicate texture of life, shared by Arabs and Jews in Jerusalem, was torn very quickly.
Under the iron,
I push open a heavy wooden door and walk down a narrow corridor to an Ethiopian chapel.
አቤቱ ካንተ ዘንድ የምንሻውን በምንለምንበት በምንጸልይበት ጊዜ እናስባቸው ዘንድ አስቡን ያሉን አስብ። አቤቱ ፈጣሪያችን እግዚአብሔር ከኛ አስቀድመው የሞቱትን አሳርፋቸው የታመሙትንም ፈጥነህ አድናቸው።
The winding path ends suddenly next to the Holy Sepulchre's main entrance.
Heureux sont-ils tous ceux qui là ont pleuré d'amour céleste. Le prêtre grec a pris une rose, l'a jetée sur la dalle, y a versé de l'eau de rose, l'a bénite et me l'a donnée. Ça a été un des moments les plus amers de ma vie, c'eût été si doux pour un fidèle. Combien de pauvres âmes auraient souhaité être à ma place, comme tout cela était perdu pour moi. Pendant que nous visitions le Saint-Sépulcre, j'ai entendu 4 heures sonner aux différentes horloges des églises.
At the end of his visit to the church, Flaubert wrote without further comment.
Le meurtre d'un juif sur la place du Saint-Sépulcre se rachète par 60 paras.
On the lowest rung of the social ladder are the Jews. One of the earliest photographs of the war, the year 1864. As a child, I was only able to see the war in photographs. It was hidden behind the border, deep within the old city. Why are the Jews so sad? Their clothes are worn, and their faces turned to a wall in ruins. Today is the 9th of Av. 1920 years have passed since the great destruction, and it is still mourned. But the state of Israel was resurrected, and its soldiers are posted on the wall above. The people at prayer. The religious establishment took over the place and erected the barrier between men and women. What I love are the old pictures of the Western Wall, a ravaged wall filled with memories, absorbing tears, comforting those who suffer. Wicker baskets hang on the wall. A donkey is tied to a fence across the way. A narrow space, 3 meters wide, at the bottom of the imposing Herodian structure. The year, 1870. Above lies the vast Temple Mount, where only Muslims could enter. Erected by Caliph Abd al-Malik, the Dome of the Rock has been standing here for 1300 years. Only from the end of the 19th century were Western visitors allowed to enter the mosques and the surrounding area. The end of the 19th century. First color photograph of the wall. The camera captured an everyday scene. Women and men are praying side by side. This is the last photo I found of people praying at the wall before the War of 48. For 19 years, the wall stood orphaned. The entire old city was in Jordanian territory. In 67, amidst the enthusiasm of the Six-Day War victory, the army foresees tens of thousands of visitors to the wall. So in one night, they demolish the entire Maghrebi quarter that hindered access to the site. In its place, a vast, ugly space was paved, blinding under the burning sun. It is hard for me to film here. After things calmed down a bit, the Dutch landscape painter Cornelius de Bruijn arrived in Jerusalem. He stood in the old cemetery, hiding his pencils for fear of being accused of spying, and secretly sketched the most precise panorama of Jerusalem made before the invention of photography.
Des andere daags morgens, de 19e oktober, vervoegde ik mij bovenop het klooster en tekende vandaar het gezicht der kerk van het heilige graf.
The building stood intact since it was abandoned by the crusaders 500 years earlier. Only the top floor of the tower was crumbling down. Today, another 300 years have passed, and the top floors of the tower have disappeared.
Indien nu iemand wil weten hoe men zich gesteld bevindt als men de eerste maal voor des heilands graf nederknielt, ik zal hem zeggen, voor zoveel mij belangt, dat ik nergens enige ontroering heb gevoeld als alleen daar.
Da
Doch ontstelde zich een der paters, mede een nieuweling in Jeruzalem, die met mij in de kerk ging vrij wat meer. Want knielde neder voor het heilige graf, berstte hij uit in zulk een overvloed van tranen en zuchten, dat hij in 2 uren nauwelijks tot bedaren was te brengen.
Jerusalem, 1806. From the travelogue of Chateaubriand.
Le guide s'écria « El Kotz, la Sainte !» et il s'enfuit au grand galop. Je restai les yeux fixés sur Jérusalem. Mesurant la hauteur de ses murs, recevant à la fois tous les souvenirs de l'histoire, depuis Abraham jusqu'à Godefroy de Bouillon, pensant au monde entier changé par la mission du Fils de l'homme, et cherchant vainement ce temple dont il ne reste pas pierre sur pierre. Comme nous approchions de la porte de la ville, porte de Jaffa, le Pacha sortait de Jérusalem. Je fus obligé d'ôter promptement le mouchoir que j'avais jeté sur mon chapeau pour me défendre du soleil, dans la crainte de m'attirer une disgrâce. Nous prîmes une rue qui se dirige de l'ouest à l'est et qu'on appelle la rue du Bazar. C'est la grande rue et le beau quartier de Jérusalem. Mais quelle désolation et quelle misère! Nous ne rencontrions personne, car la plupart des habitants s'étaient retirés dans la montagne à l'arrivée du Pacha. À la droite du bazar, nous entrâmes dans le quartier des Juifs. Ceux-ci, fortifiés par leur misère, avaient bravé l'assaut du Pacha. Ils étaient là, tous en guenilles, assis dans la poussière de Sion, cherchant les insectes qui les dévoraient, et les yeux attachés sur le temple. Le dragoman me fit entrer dans une espèce d'école. Je voulus acheter le Pentateuque hébreu dans lequel un rabbin montrait à lire à un enfant. Mais le rabbin ne voulut jamais me le vendre.
Chateaubriand stayed in the city for several days.
Le 12 octobre, nous sortîmes de la ville au coucher du soleil par la porte des pèlerins. Nous traversâmes le camp du Pacha. Je m'arrêtai avant de descendre dans la vallée de Térébinthe pour regarder encore Jérusalem. Il était 6h29 minutes lorsque je perdus de vue la cité sainte. Le navigateur marque ainsi le moment où disparaît à ses yeux une terre lointaine qu'il ne reverra jamais.
The city was at its lowest ebb. Only 4,000 Muslims, 2,500 Christians, and 2,000 Jews lived within her walls.
Thank you.
The French poet Lamartine walks around the city walls, stands before the open, desolate gates, but is unable to enter. A plague is ravaging the city.
Le même vide, le même silence que si nous eussions passé devant les portes mortes de Pompéi ou l'Herculanum. Nous ne vîmes que quatre convois funèbres sortir en silence de la porte de Damas et s'acheminer le long des murs vers les cimetières turcs.
Lamartine was forced to stay at St. John's Monastery in the mountainous village of Enkarem, west of Jerusalem, believed to be the birthplace of St. John the Baptist.
Du toit du couvent, on plonge toutes parts sur des abîmes sans fond. Quelques pauvres maisons d'arabes mahométans et chrétiens sont groupées sur le rocher à l'ombre du monastère.
The windows of my house look eastward on St. John's Monastery. Here, in an old house which I renovated, I have lived for more than 20 years. I have distanced myself from Judaism. End of 1839, the first photographer, Goupil Fesquet, appears in Jerusalem, accompanied by his uncle, the renowned painter Horace Vernet. All the photos were lost. All that remains is the photographer's illustrated journal.
La pluie qui tombe assez abondamment nous accompagne partout. Néanmoins, elle ne m'empêche point de faire quelques daguerréotypes. Une épreuve des remparts prise du côté du château de David me paraît digne de la reproduction photogénique. Je m'enveloppe donc d'un grand abat noir qui me sert de guérite et, me dirigeant vers la montagne voisine, je braque ma chambre obscure sur le point de vue que je désire, après avoir longtemps examiné le site et cherché des petites pierres convenables pour consolider l'appareil. Pendant que je me livre à l'orientation de mon daguerréotype, il fait un vent très désagréable qui dérange l'équilibre de mon installation et troublera infailliblement les contours de mon épreuve. Pour surcroît de misère, deux juifs qui se promènent près de moi vont et viennent devant l'objectif sans qu'il me soit possible de leur en faire comprendre l'inconvénient. Ils s'approchent de moi, je leur fais signe de s'éloigner, ils n'en font rien. L'un d'eux se met à rire et se place exprès pour me contrarier devant la lentille. Irrité de ce procédé, je le prends par les épaules et le pousse à quatre pas de là. Son camarade le remplace au poste perdu. Je reviens à la charge et j'y ajoute quelques bons coups de poing solidement appliqués. J'en distribue libéralement à l'un et à l'autre et je suis étonné de l'imperturbable lâcheté avec laquelle chacun d'eux reçoit alternativement sa dose, sans essayer même de se défendre le moins du monde. Finalement, ils comprennent qu'ils m'ont importuné et s'en vont, sans montrer aucune apparence de ressentiment, regagnant le plus affreux quartier de la ville.
The French photographer didn't know that during those very days, the Jews of Jerusalem were expecting the imminent coming of the Messiah as the year 5600 had already begun. The Messiah didn't arrive. After hundreds of years, construction in Jerusalem had begun again. 6,000 Muslims, 4,000 Christians, and 8,000 Jews live within the city walls by 1860. Near Jaffa Gate, inside the old city, a new hotel is being built, the Grand New Hotel. The pile of stones on the ground is for the second floor. Jaffa Road, a stream of passers-by all day long. Around the Mamila pool at the Muslim cemetery, women and men gaze at the water. In the background, the first houses of the Mamila neighborhood. The first cinematographer arrives in Jerusalem, sent by the Lumiere brothers. Instead of filming the famous sites, he sets up his camera near Jaffa Gate, the busiest place in the city, and films its inhabitants. On the other side of the gate, he recalls a row of Turkish soldiers returning to the citadel. The municipality of Jerusalem resides in the triangular building seen in the background. It was built on the corner of Jaffa and Mamila roads, the center of the new city. Morning, December 25, 1994. For 8 years, I have been working on this film. In the meantime, Noah is already a soldier. Yael is 17, before her last high school exams. And Naomi is 15. This is how the Jaffa Gate looked 100 years ago. Bonfils, the photographer, searches out the vantage point on the Jaffa Road, the first street outside the walls. He stood behind a window overlooking the Jaffa Mamila junction. The building no longer exists. In the introduction to his book, Bonfils wrote,
"No country has been destroyed over and over again in wars more than this one. And no country has seen more rulers come and go. And despite all that, this country, holy to all, has perhaps more than any other country preserved its ancient character. But we have to hurry if we wish to enjoy what our eyes behold. Progress, that great deceiver, will surely hasten its destructive handiwork of what time itself has treated with respect." In the ancient plain of Charonne, the shriek of a locomotive engine is already to be heard. Perhaps the day is not far off when the Holy Mount of Olives will have its own cable car like every other tourist site. Before this comes about, we have tried to immortalize the country, as it were, freezing it in a series of photographic shots.
Traffic jam at the Jaffa Gate. The Turks decide to undertake large-scale development works. They fill in the deep moat from the Crusader period, enabling access of wagons in the bridge between the citadel and the ancient gate. Here, you feel the pulse of the New Jerusalem. In the last days of the Ottoman Empire, the Turks built on the Jaffa Gate a clock tower of new white stone. Among the many photographs I collected, I found a postcard of Ain Karim, a small village 2 hours' walk from the Jaffa Gate. For over 20 years, I've lived in Ain Karim. My house is on the hill, opposite the Church of John the Baptist. Beyond the house, fields. Among the fields, at the top of the hill, there's a long building surrounded by walls. This is where Jerusalem ends today. On the patio, Yael interviews my parents. She has to prepare a report about her family history for school.
Eli ben Yosef Chavilo, Mishnat 1472, Bisfarad. Mu'uchar yoter, aya Rabbi David Chavilo, Ish Kabbalah Gadol. Ata yodat ma ze Kabbalah?
Whereas my father was always very proud of his family origins, I knew very little about my mother's side, the Rosenthal family.
צריך להדגיש שזה היה בתקופה שהאנשים היו לוחמות של ממש.
עכשיו...
לא בשירות העזר. ככה שחיה, שקט, אני פה כתוב. כך שחיה הייתה בעצמה מפקדת חזית.
אני עליתי להר ציון בלילה שכבשו את זה, הפלמ"ח כבש את זה, ואחר כך היו באמת חיילות בהר ציון, והם היו בעמדות, בתפקידים קשים. למה הגברים לא... היה קשה להסביר, כי בעיר היו להם משפחות, וכל הזמן היו הפגזות.
Jaffa Gate in wartime. Jamal Pasha, high commander of the Turkish army, leaves the city on his way to the front. The winds of violence sweeping across the world have reached this place. People are being hanged at the Jaffa Gate as deserters, spies, or mere suspects. A sign on the victim gives some explanation. Its real intention: to intimidate the population.
Father, who had to carry baked foods to the market, could have been caught at any time by the Turkish secret police, who roamed the streets to catch any man who looked fit for the army. When the gallop of the secret police was heard, all the men would run away. When they caught someone who didn't have the strength to flee, he would be gasping like a fish in their claws, listless, stiff with fear, the face contorted. They took the conscripts away, nobody knew where.
No, I said, lo yam mira kartitsa. As I think, I said, lo yam mira kartitsa. A villa, I don't know if Tara will have a java. I need to give him Bugar, I just call my spoon.
I had to take on some of the burden of earning a living. The first thing I did was to take cakes my mother had baked. I gathered courage and came to the Jaffa Gate. I sat on some steps with my tray, and from time to time I shouted, "Hot cakes, hot cakes." At first the sales went well, but very quickly people stopped paying attention and left me alone. By sunset, my success was so minimal that I walked around crying soundlessly. Eventually, my efforts were in vain, and when the flour in the city ran out, I stopped, without knowing what would happen to my starving family.
Austrian soldiers pass in front of the Jaffa Gate. Jamal Pasha welcomes General Erich von Falkenhayn at the Jerusalem railway station. The Prussian general, von Kressenstein. The general sits in his car at the entrance to Hotel Fast. Hunger and plagues spread across the country.
At evening, when darkness brought bitter sadness upon me, I would follow Hamid, the Arab shepherd, who brought his shriveled sheep and goats to the marketplace. When he finished milking them, he would set pieces of kuzba, the leftovers from pressing olive oil. It's brown and has a bittersweet taste, and he gave us kids a little. Sometimes we would take what fell from the goat's mouth, pieces wet from the saliva and full of the smell of their manure. This was our dinner.
My grandfather, Nisim Khavilio, was 30 years older than Sarina. He had 7 children from his first wife, who died during the war. After the wedding, Sarina posed with her mother and younger sisters. She would soon give birth to my father and call him Shlomo after her own father. December 9, 1917. The victorious British army is approaching Jerusalem. A delegation of notables carrying a white flag goes out to surrender. In one of Larson's photos, the mayor El Husseini presents the keys of the city to 2 British sergeants who have lost their way. It reminds me of the heroic surrender of the city of Breda in the Velázquez picture. I reflect on the power of a photo to reveal the real face of war, the face of absurdity.
ביום שבת, לפני שהצבא הבריטי נכנס, הטורקים עזבו את המשרדים, והצעירים הירושלמים הלכו לבניינים האלה לתפוס שלל.
אפרים פריצקי is my mother's uncle. I sat with him in the car by the Jaffa gate. When the British conquered Jerusalem, Ephraim was 7 years old.
וגם אני הבאתי הביתה ארגז תרופות, ואבא גירש אותי עם ארגז התרופות האלה. ולמוחרתו ביום שישי התחילו לצאת לראות איך החיילים האנגלים מגיעים, ואני הייתי בין אלה שיצאתי לשער יפו וראיתי שגלים גלים עולים החיל הרגלים הבריטי, עייפים ורצוצים, והם שכבו על הרצפה לנוח, על השכבה. ואנחנו חשבנו לתומנו, החיילים האלה יכלו לגרש את הטורקים.
The British hastened to correct the bad impression made by the soldiers, turning from matters of war to stage with great pomp a triumphal entry into the holy city. they marched along the Jaffa Road. Half the Jews that had been in Jerusalem on the eve of the war are no longer in the city. 9,000 had died of illness and hunger. The rest were driven out, conscripted, or had fled the border. Winter 1918. The war drags on in the north of the country. A convoy of camels of the British Supply Corps makes its way slowly along the Jaffa Road next to the gate, passing below the clock tower. The English did not think much of the clock tower above the Jaffa Gate. They found it eclectic in style, spoiling the biblical impression of the walls. It was dismantled a few months after the great snowfall of 1920. January 1992. Snow fell the whole night. For many years, Jerusalem had not been seen in such a white covering. During the winter of 1920, snow had fallen unceasingly for a week, the heaviest snow ever recorded in the city. Many old houses were damaged, people froze from the cold. Outside the old city, the Jaffa Road was blocked off. A narrow path makes its way to the Jaffa Gate. On the left is the clock tower. To the right, the citadel. Next to the Jaffa Gate, I was caught in a snowstorm. Here, the wall is bare, providing no shelter. All the buildings that stood here on both sides of Jaffa Road were destroyed long ago. Inside the old city, within the citadel, I went into the Petra Hotel. In the Ottoman period, wealthy travelers from distant lands would stay here. Melting snow drips in from the roof and floods the splendid marble floors. The windows look out over the Church of the Holy Sepulchre and Hezekiah's ancient pool. Today, the hotel is neglected and serves as a hostel for young tourists. Old wooden steps lead up to the roof. In 1920, Yaakov Ben Dov took from here a photo of the Jewish quarter with the domes of the synagogues. The ancient palm tree can still be seen in the picture. The large dome to the right is that of the Chorva synagogue. It collapsed in 1948 when the Arab Legion blew up the building. The Havilio family lived for decades in this house next to the Chorva synagogue. Here my father was born, 1 year after the great snow, in April 1921. It's here, on the Temple Mount, that during the 1920s, the stirring up of the crowds of faithful Muslims led to the first acts of violence against the Jews.
אז אני זוכר, בקצה הגבול בין אירופה לשוק, היו יושבים על דרגשים, שוטרים בריטים, שוטרים ערבים, שוטרים יהודים, ושומרים על הפתח של הרבה, שלא ייכנסו הערבים לרבה. ואני כילד הייתי עומד לפעמים שעות להסתכל על השוטרים ולהסתכל על הרבים שלהם ולנחש איך הם יורים. אני מדבר על גיל של 6-7. אז זה הים כבר אז מעניין אותי איך הרבה יורים.
A cross reflected in a puddle of water. Jews didn't live in the Christian quarter, perhaps because of a deep-rooted fear of the cross. Many preferred to live in the Muslim quarter. Today, however, danger to Jews in Israel could come from the Muslim world. I'm afraid to venture into the dark alleys, and I keep to the main axis of Elwad Street. I've walked down the Via Dolorosa and come to the Muslim quarter. Next to the sixth station of the cross, an Arab child tries to draw my attention to a small souvenir store named after Saint Veronica.
Santa Veronica left the shop. Santa Veronica is the face of Jesus.
When Jesus passed by here, staggering under the cross, Veronica wiped his brow. Jesus' features were left traced on Veronica's white handkerchief. Many photographers before me stood here by the fifth station to catch a picturesque view of the Via Dolorosa. For hundreds of years, this barred window has looked out on the intersection of Via Dolorosa and Elwad Street. Elwad winds its way along the lower side of the old city. It's the main artery of the Muslim quarter. Above the street, a house which was once splendid, a vestige of the great days of Islamic culture. British now rule Palestine. The month my father was born, a photo was taken of the new rulers in Cairo. Churchill, Secretary of State for the colonies, sits next to Herbert Samuel, the first High Commissioner of Palestine. before the picture, a red oriental carpet has been spread outside. Stretched out on it, two predators from the colonial jungles. Next to them is the tamer, probably Sudanese. Jerusalem, Indian soldiers of His Majesty the King before the ancient citadel. At the Jaffa Gate, they are checking passers-by. This is where the violent conflict between Jews and Arabs first broke out. Jaffa Gate, early 1920s, a quiet winter's day. The clock tower is gone. The Ottoman crescent is still painted on the gate. The 1930s along the Jaffa Road. A zeppelin flies over the sky of Jerusalem like a bad omen. All the buildings in the photo, up to the Citadel Tower, which can be seen on the horizon, will disappear in the rapidly approaching storm. The Nazi flag was raised by the German owners of the Fast Hotel. 1936. Riots at the Jaffa Gate. A wave of national extremism sweeps up the Arab masses. They rebel against British authority. They attack Jews. Going to civil war, bands of armed gangs under the sway of the Mufti of Jerusalem murder around 2,000 Arab intellectuals and moderates. In Europe, at the same time, the Second World War is raging. But when I look at Father's photo album, I see happy young people, always together, climbing over rocks, breathing in the Mediterranean air. Here in this country, for this once, the war passed it by. On the thick binding of the family album, Herzl's portrait is engraved, and in the first page, a copy of Haaretz from November 30.
Afghanistan? No. Argentina?
The United Nations decides by a majority to establish a Jewish state.
Belgium? Yes. Bolivia? Yes.
An Arab-Palestinian state Brazil? Alongside it?
Yes.
And Jerusalem declared an international
Russia?
City?
Yes. Canada? Yes. Chile? נפשי אלייך כה נחשפת ארצנו הקטנטונת ארצנו הקטנטונת אמי שלי שלי קטנה את בניך תכה אחרי אלפיים שנות גלות אלייך חזרתי אליי חזרתי, את היחידה שלי. ארצנו הקטנטונת, ארצנו הקטנטונת.
On one of the inside pages of that same newspaper, there's a notice about the marriage ceremony of father and mother on December 2nd in Pension Vita in Jerusalem at 3:30 in the afternoon. December 2nd, 1947, 9:30 a.m. A seething Arab mob moves through the Jaffa Gate and bursts into Mamila Street. From there, it fans out into the new commercial center. the British police evacuate Jews from the center, preventing Haganah units from entering the area, but does not stop the Arab rioters. They burst into Jewish stores, breaking, looting, vandalizing all within reach, setting them on fire. The echoes of the explosions and the sight of the thick smoke reaches all the way to Zion Square. A raging Jewish crowd tries to reach the commercial center. Shortly after, Jewish youth and members of the Irgun set fire to the Rex cinema.
הייתי טרוד בכל הנושאים האלו של כוננות, גיוס, הצטיידות של היישובים. ופתאום אני שם לב ואני רואה שכבר שעות הצהריים המאוחרות ונזכרתי שיש לי חתונה, שאני צריך להתחתן. ואז כמובן עזבתי הכל ורצתי הביתה. רצתי הביתה למחנה יהודה להתלבש. הם כבר היו כולם על קוצים, הם כבר מוכנים היו, היא הייתה לבושה, כולם היו לבושים כדי לגשת לחתונה.
Delicate texture of life, shared by Arabs and Jews in Jerusalem, was torn very quickly. Under the